गुड मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रन, वेलकम टू आवर यूट्यूब चैनल अकेडमिया अम्बाला। टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट विद द सेकेंड पार्ट ऑफ चैप्टर 5 हिस्ट्री, दैट इज द एज ऑफ इंडस्ट्रियलाइजेशन पार्ट 2। मैनचेस्टर कम्स टू इंडिया। बाय द बिगिनिंग ऑफ द 19th सेंचुरी टेक्सटाइल एक्सपोर्ट्स फ्रॉम इंडिया डिक्लाइंड। इन 1811 12 पीस गुड्स accounted for 33% of India's exports. By 1850-51, it was no more than 3%. As cotton industry developed in England, industrial groups began worrying about imports from other countries. They pressurized the government to impose import duties on cotton textiles. At the same time, industrial persuaded the East India Company to sell British manufacturers in Indian markets as well. By the 1850, cotton piece goods constituted over 31% of the value of Indian imports, and by the 1870s this figure was over 50%. With the coming of Manchester in India, the Indian industries are facing lots of problems. The problems faced by cotton weavers in India we will discuss here. Their export market collapsed and the local market shrank, being glutted with Manchester imports. Imported goods were so cheap that weavers could not easily compete with them. By the 1860s, weaver could not get sufficient supply of raw cotton of good quality. As raw cotton exports from India increased, the price of raw cotton shot up. Weavers in the India were starved of supplies and forced to buy raw cotton at exorbitant prices. By the end of the 19th century, factories in India began production, flooding the market with machine goods. How could weaving industry possibly survive? Factories come up. The first cotton mill in Bombay came up in 1854. By 1862, four mills were at work with 94,000 spindles and 2,150 looms. Around the same time, jute mills came up in Bengal, the first being set up in 1855. In North India, the Elgin mill was started in Kanpur in the 1860s, and a year later the first cotton mill of Ahmedabad was set up. By 1874, the first spinning and weaving mill of Madras began production. The pictures shown on your screen are the images of few Indian industrialists, the early entrepreneurs. From the late 18th century, British in India began exporting opium to China. Many Indian became junior players in this trade, providing finance, procuring supplies and shipping consignments, having earned through trade. Some of these businessmen had vision of developing industrial enterprises in India. In Bengal, Dwarkanath Tagore set up 6 joint stock companies in the 1830s and 1840s. In Bombay, Parsis like Dinsha Petit and Jamshedji Nusrivanji Tata built huge industrial empires. Seth Hukumchand set up the first Indian jute mill in Calcutta in 1970. So did the father as well as grandfather of famous industrialist G.D. Birla. Now, the question arises here, how the early entrepreneurs accumulated their capital. Some merchants from Madras traded with Burma, others had links with Middle East and East Africa. Other commercial groups operated within India, carrying goods from one place to another, banking money, transferring funds between cities and financing traders. Now, there was lots of hurdles in the path of Indian entrepreneurs. As colonial control over Indian trade tightened, the space within which Indian merchants could function became increasingly limited. They were barred from trading with Europe in manufacturing goods and had to transport mostly raw materials and food grains. European managing agencies controlled a large sector of Indian industries. These agencies mobilized capital, set up joint stock companies and managed them. The European merchant industrialists had their own chambers of commerce, which Indian businessmen were not allowed to join. In most industrial regions, workers came from the district around. Peasants and artisans who found no work in the village went to the industrial centers in search of work. Most often, mill workers moved between the village and the city, returning to their village homes during harvest and festivals. Workers traveled great distances in the hope of work in the mills. From the United Provinces, they went to work in the textile mills of Bombay and in the jute mills of Calcutta. Jobber. Getting jobs was always difficult. The numbers seeking work were always more than the jobs available. Entry into the mills were also restricted. Industrialists usually employed a jobber to get new recruits. He got people from his village, ensured them jobs, helped them settle in city, and provided them money in times of crisis. This person is known as the jobber. Now we will discuss about the peculiarities of industrial growth. European managing agencies established tea and coffee plantations, acquiring land at cheap rates from the colonial government, and they invested in mining indigo and jute. Indian businessmen avoided competing with Manchester goods, produced coarse cotton yarn rather than fabric. Yarn produced in Indian spinning mills was used by handloom weavers in India or exported to China. When the Swadeshi movement gathered momentum, industrial groups organized themselves to protect their collective interest, pressurizing the government to increase tariff protection and grant other concessions. From 1906, industrialists in India began shifting from yarn to cloth production. Cotton piece goods production in India doubled between 1900 and 1912. There is great impact of First World War on Indian industries. With British mills busy with war production to meet with the needs of army, Indian mills had a vast home market to supply. As the demand in England went up, Indian factories were called upon to supply war needs. New factories were set up and old within the colonies, local industrialists gradually consolidated their position, substituting foreign manufacturers and capturing the home market. Once ran multiple shifts. Many new workers were employed and everyone was made to work longer hours. Over the years, industrial production boomed. After the war, Manchester could never recapture its old position in the Indian market. Cotton production collapsed and export of cotton clothes from Britain fell dramatically. While factory industries grew steadily after the war, large industries formed only a small segment of the economy. Small-scale production continued to predominate. Only a small proportion of the total industrial labor force worked in registered factories. The rest worked in small workshops and household units. Handicraft production actually expanded in the 20th century. While cheap machine-made thread wiped out the spinning industry in the 19th century, the weavers survived despite problems. In the 20th century, handloom cloth production expanded steadily, almost trebling between 1900 and 1940. By the second decade of the 20th century, we find weavers using looms with a fly shuttle. This increased productivity per worker, speeded up production, and reduced labor demand. Certain groups of weavers were in a better position than others to survive the competition with mill industries. The coarser cloth was bought by the poor and its demand fluctuated violently. The demand for the finer varieties bought by the well-to-do was more stable. The rich could buy these even when the poor starved. Famines did not affect the sale of Banarsi or Baluchri sarees. Mills could not imitate specialized weaves, sarees with woven borders, or the famous lungis and handkerchiefs of Madras could not be easily displaced by mill production. Weavers and other craft people who continued to expand production through the 20th century did not necessarily prosper. They lived hard lives and worked long hours. but they were not simply remnants of past times in the age of factories. Their life and labor was integral to the process of industrialization. Now we will discuss about the measures adopted by the producers in India to expand the market for their goods in the 19th century. Advertisements made products appear desirable and necessary. They tried to shape the mind of people and create new goods. From the very beginning of the industrial age, advertisements have played a part in the expanding the market for products and in shaping a new consumer culture. When Manchester industrialists began selling cloth in India, they put labels on the cloth bundles. When buyers saw "Made in Manchester" written in bold on the label, they were expected to feel confident about buying the cloth. Labels also carried images and were very often beautifully illustrated. Images of Indian gods and goddesses regularly appeared on these labels. It was as if the association with gods gave divine approval. The goods being sold was also intended to make the manufacture from a foreign land appear somewhat familiar to the Indian people. By the late 19th century, manufacturers were printing calendars to popularize their products. Unlike newspapers and magazines, calendars were used even by people who could not read. They were hung in tea shops and in poor people's homes just as much as in offices and the middle class apartments. Like the images of gods, figures of important personages of emperors and nawabs adorned advertisements and calendars. The message, "If you respect the royal figure, then respect this product." When the product was being used by kings or produced under royal command, its quality could not be questioned. When Indian manufacturers advertised, the nationalist message was clear and loud. "If you care for the nation, then buy products that Indians produce." Advertisements became a vehicle of the nationalist message of Swadeshi.
Okay, children, this is all about your chapter. Thank you.